Church, could you please stand and join us in song?
Today. the shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, for nothing has the power to save. But your name is a strong and mighty tower, your name. It's a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, for nothing has the power to save but your name.
Been seeking truth, traveled from afar. singing this morning. And we're going to do our actual offering time at this point. We put up that song on the screen, and folks were getting their wallets out and things like that, and the guys in the back were confused, saying, I thought there was another song and all that. So that is a song entitled Christmas Offering, but I think it prepares our hearts well for the offering time that we're going to give here this morning. And we're going to, I just want to remind you this morning that we've got two more weeks to give towards the Christmas offering this year for the Nazarene Fund. If you haven't given in towards that yet, I'd encourage you to do that today, or if you're going to be here next week, you can do that one more time next Sunday morning as we give to that that needy group and the work that they are doing to get people the help that they need around the world. Christians and people groups are being persecuted for their faith. And they're doing a wonderful job, so it'd be a worthy use of your Christmas offering this year. But let's prepare to give our tithes and offerings to the Lord this morning. If I could have some gentlemen help me with this, we will give and ask God's blessing on the funds as it's given here today. And I tell you, you can be seated there. Thank you. I appreciate everybody who participated last week in just continuing things while we were gone. And there's a lot of little things that have to get done around here to make a Sunday morning worship service happen. And I appreciate all those who participated, those who helped. Our sound guys even did a great job. I gave them a laundry list of things to do, and they did great with what they always do. But appreciate all of you being here this morning. But why don't we pray? We'll ask God's blessing on the funds as they're given here today. And Brother Mike, would you lead us in prayer, sir? Amen. And we've got a special instrumental here this morning as the trio comes along here this morning. They've got a special clarinet trio for us here today. Heard them before the service, and they did an awesome job. And just another song to remind us about the beauty of Christmas. And as we give funds to the Lord this morning, then we'll move on to our kids' time this morning. Job. Well, they did a great job, didn't they? That's awesome. Thank you guys for sharing that this morning. I'm going to ask my wife to come at this time, and we're going to do our story time with the kids before they dismiss for Children's Church. So you guys, Children's Church age, come on up, find a spot, and Miss Heather's going to come read to you guys. And, that's right. You're going to need that. So before Miss Heather reads, I do want to tell you about something to be on the lookout for today, guys. Some of you already have seen these, but we've got something special for you here today, and we're going to do this next week as well. Over the weekend of service a couple weeks ago, we dispensed around town some little wooden discs that have a painting of Jesus, baby Jesus, on it. And it was just a way to spread a little cheer, give people something to look forward to as they moved around town. And I wanted to give you guys an opportunity to get that as well. So around the building today, look at the Christmas decorations, guys. And you are going to see a little wooden disc. It looks like this, with a painting of baby Jesus on it. And also there's a rock, a white marble rock that looks like this. And it's got baby Jesus on it. Whoever finds that and brings it back to me after the service, probably not a good time to do it right now, right? But after the service, if you can find this or this and bring it to me, then I will give you an entire nativity set made from the same stuff, okay? And I'll explain to you how you use it. It's just paintings of the different characters in the Christmas story, baby Jesus, the wise men, Mary and Joseph, all of those things, so that you can have your own nativity set at home. You can break it out and look at it. You can tell the story of Jesus and his birth to your family, your friends, things like that. So it's just a gift from the church just to say Merry Christmas to you guys. So be on the lookout for that. But Miss Heather has got a special book for you guys to read today.
Can you hear me now? Okay. All right. I have a special book to read today. It's called The Sparkle Box. How many of you have presents under the tree already?
Me.
Poor Tori. You really don't. Mommy's kind of running late on wrapping presents. But but I'm going to read a story today about a special box. And it's a special present for a very special person, okay? So I want you to listen up, and I'm going to try to do my best to hold the book and the microphone at the same time. So, all right, here we go. Snowflakes swirled through the air as Sam and his mom stopped to look in the toy store window. With Christmas only a few weeks away, Sam needed to make his Christmas list. He tugged on his mom's sleeve and pointed to the train. He loved the shiny red engine. Later, as Sam and his mom curled up on the couch to read a Christmas book, something sparkly on the mantle caught his eye. "Mom, is that a present for me?" he asked. Sam's mom tousled his hair. "It's a special gift called a sparkle box. We'll open it together later, but we need to fill it first." Sam was excited, but it was hard to wait. Driving home from school the next day, Sam's mom stopped at a building he had never been to before. She asked him to help her carry in some food and blankets. Sam peeked into the bag he was carrying and noticed a box of macaroni and cheese, his favorite. "What are we doing with this stuff, Mom?" She smiled and said, "We're giving it to people who don't have enough food to eat or blankets to keep them warm." But inside the building, Sam didn't see anyone who looked cold or hungry, just a nice lady with a big smile who thanked them. On the way home, they drove by the park. It was dusk, and the pretty Christmas lights had just come on. As they stopped at a traffic light, Sam noticed someone on a bench, curled up and sleeping. His mother noticed, too. "That's someone who may get one of our blankets," she said softly. "He doesn't have anywhere to live." Sam felt bad. It would be sad not to have a home to live in, wouldn't it?
He's on the bench right there.
Yeah. Sam hung up his coat. It was good to be home. As he sat at the kitchen table to have a snack, he noticed the sparkle box gleaming on the mantle. "Mom, did you put anything in the sparkle box yet?" he asked shyly. "Well, actually, I did put something in it today," she answered. "But it's still not ready to be opened. We need to add a couple more things to it." Sam wondered what was inside. Do you have any idea? The days flew by, and soon it was time for one of Sam's favorite events, the Christmas party at his dad's office. There was always lots of delicious food and a present for every child at the party. Sam's dad thanked everyone for coming. He talked about how blessed they were when many people in the world struggle for something as simple as clean water to drink. He said a village in Africa would receive a special gift this year thanks to money donated by employees and their families. The gift was a well that would provide clean water for the entire village. Sam asked his mom if his family helped. "Yes, dear, we did." He looked around. The grown-ups were smiling, but he saw tears too. "Happy tears," his mom whispered. As his dad tucked him into the bed that night, Sam thought about his Christmas list, and that reminded him of another present. "Daddy, did you and Mom fill up the sparkle box yet?" Sam asked. "Well, we added something to it tonight, but it's still not ready to be opened." Sam drifted off to sleep, imagining what could be inside. A few days later, Sam was filled with excitement as he shopped with his mom. Tomorrow was his school party. There was a Christmas tree called a mitten tree where the kids could hang mittens, hats, and scarves for people who needed them. Sam picked out the biggest pair of mittens he could find. He also bought a candy bar for himself with his own money. When he turned to leave, Sam heard the tinkling of bells. He looked up and saw the man from the park bench coming in the door. The man seemed tired. Sam looked at the candy bar in his hand and thought about the mittens in his bag. He looked at the man's hands. They looked cold. Sam's heart began to pound. What do you think he's going to do? As quick as a wink, Sam slipped his candy bar into the bag with the mittens and pressed the bag into the man's hands. Sam ran out the door shouting, "Merry Christmas!" His mom gave him a hug. "I'm so proud of you," she whispered. "I know that wasn't easy, but you brought a little light into his world tonight." That was really nice, wasn't it? Sam asked his mom if they could drive by the park. As he watched the flame on a giant candle blink on and off, he thought about how unfair it was that some people didn't have a home to live in or food to eat. You know that? Some people don't. Soon it was Christmas Eve, the most special night of the year. Sam and his family gathered at their church for a Christmas Eve service. They sang songs and listened to the story of the first Christmas. Then in the darkened sanctuary, a single candle was lit. That candle was used to light other candles, and soon everyone was carefully passing the flame from one person to the next, until the whole room was filled with a magical light. Sam looked around. How lovely, how peaceful they all looked as they shared the light. We have a Christmas Eve service coming up. On Christmas morning, Sam ran downstairs as fast as he could. Under the tree was the train with the shiny red engine. And what was that? The sparkle box. Sam could hardly wait to open it. Are you ready to find out? He sat on his mom's lap with his dad snuggled in close. Sam slowly lifted the lid of the box. Inside, there were just a few pieces of paper with words written on them. Puzzled, he took the papers out and began to read the words out loud. "Mittens and a candy bar given to someone in need. Warm blankets and food for the homeless. A well in Africa that will provide clean drinking water." Sam's mom explained, "Sam, this sparkle box is our gift to Jesus on Christmas Day, his birthday." Sam was confused. "But we didn't give Jesus a gift. We gave things to people who needed them." His mom smiled. "You're right, and no gift could make Jesus happier. He taught us that whatever we do for people in need, we do for him. So each year, we'll think of some special gifts to give Jesus. We'll write down these gifts and put them in the sparkle box. On Christmas morning, we'll open the box and read out loud the gifts we gave in honor of his birthday." Sam thought about the man curled up on the park bench, the mittens and the soft blankets, the well that would bring clean water to a village in Africa. He looked at his mom and smiled through tears. "Happy tears," Sam whispered. The end. Wasn't that a good story? You know what? It is Jesus' birthday on Christmas, isn't it? We should think about things to give to Jesus, not just about things that we should get for his birthday, right? All right. Thanks for being such good listeners.
All right, guys, we're going to dismiss you guys to Children's Church at this time. Thank you guys for doing such a good job listening. And it wasn't too hard. That was a good book. And I hope you guys will think about that, about somebody that you can help this Christmas season and be a blessing to. All right. Well, and by the way, parents, next Sunday, the kids are going to be singing here in the morning service, singing some Christmas carols that they've been working on for several weeks now. So it'd be a good weekend to invite family out and friends out to come and hear your kids singing on next Sunday morning. So I appreciate that. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 6 together this morning. If you'd turn there with me, Matthew chapter 6, we're going to get into our study time here today. And it's good to be back. It is good to be back in Unionville and back home, sleeping in my bed and eating my food out of my fridge and just getting back to the normal swing of things after 2 weeks of vacation and being in the car and all those things. It sure is nice to be back here, and it's nice to be here with you all as well. And, you know, you enjoy being away for a little bit, but I miss worshiping here at Midway. So good to see you here today. And thank you, those of you that participated in getting the Christmas decorations up. And it's nice to see them up and the building decorated and some new ideas even being put out there. I like it. I like the innovation of it. So thank you so much for all of your help with that. And it looks beautiful around here. But I understand Tom Rowland did a good job last week while I was gone, and I hope that he was a blessing to you while he was here. Unfortunately, I am not as brief as Tom is, so that was your 1 week off, and we're back at it now. But here in Matthew chapter 6, we're going to read together a few verses, and I want to share with you a little bit of a story and then some application for us here today. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 25. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, the Bible says, "Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore take no thought, saying, What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things did the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." And so we're going to get started with our third message in this series on the spirits of Christmas as we're moving through the story of Ebenezer Scrooge in A Christmas Carol. We've talked about in week one, Jacob Marley, and how Ebenezer Scrooge, this old hard-hearted miser, this wealthy man, but this very cold and hateful man, he is reintroduced to an old friend of his, Jacob Marley, as Jacob returns from the grave and he meets with Scrooge and tells him that he's wasted his life life. He's thrown his life away, and he's accomplished nothing. For all the wealth that he has, for all of the things that he can buy, he has nothing to show for it. He has not made a difference with the life that he's been given. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again, that God holds us accountable for two things: for the abilities that we have and the opportunities that we've been given. When you stand before God someday, you will not be held accountable for my abilities and my opportunities, and I will not be held accountable for your abilities and your opportunities, but we will be held accountable for the abilities that God has given to us and how we use them, and the opportunities that we've been given, and the opportunities that we've had to make a difference. However big or however small that might seem, you and I will be held accountable for that. And so Jacob Marley tells Scrooge, you've wasted your life, you've thrown it all away, and if you do not change the affliction that I am enduring, the afterlife that I'm enduring, you will endure. And we talked about how A Christmas Carol isn't a theological book. It is a fiction book. There's a lot of creative liberties taken there. The ideas of disembodied spirits wandering the earth, that's nowhere in Scripture. That's an unbiblical idea. But the point still holds true that we have one opportunity to get this life right. We will not get a replay. There is no reset button in life. You may get that in a video game, but you don't get that in life. You have one opportunity to make a difference, and so we better make a difference while we have the opportunity to do so. And then in week number two, we talked about the fact that Ebenezer Scrooge was confronted with a second spirit, the spirit of Christmas past. And the spirit of Christmas past rewinds Scrooge's life and shows him that he has that the Christmases of his past should not have turned him against Christmas, should not have turned him against Christ and against the goodness of life. It should have, in fact, turned his heart towards Christmas. This man who hates Christmas, who calls it a humbug, has enjoyed pleasant days in Christmas past. And why does Ebenezer Scrooge hate Christmas? Why has he become a hard-hearted, hateful person? The only person responsible for that is Ebenezer Scrooge. He can't blame anyone else. He can't blame his past. Many times in the movies of A Christmas Carol, they try to paint this picture that Scrooge had daddy issues, that his dad was unkind and hateful to him, and so he's unkind and hateful to others. But the book actually says the opposite, that Scrooge's father's heart changed. And the idea, the implication, is that that man came to Christ, and a radical transformation happened, and he fell in love with his family, fell in love with his children, because Jesus Christ made the difference there. And Scrooge began to enjoy a good father, a man who was an example of Christ to him. And so Scrooge has no one to blame but himself. And we learn from the Ghosts of Christmas Past that regret is often needless and avoidable. That many times the reasons we have regret is our own fault, our own doing, that we are the reason for our regret. We can't just point the finger at somebody else and say, it's that person, and if I'd had this opportunity and if life had gone this way, it would have worked out. Now, there are times when things that are unavoidable happen. There's times where you're sitting in the doctor's office and you get a diagnosis that you did not expect. There's nothing you can do about that. There are times when people come in and out of our lives and we can't really impact that or affect that. That's true. But many times, the reasons that we go through the regret that we have is because of bad choices that we have made. And why do we make bad choices? Because of bad character. We either are uninformed, we don't have all the information to make the right decision, or we don't have the right character to take the right steps in life. A lot of times we get upset with people and we say, why do they act the way they act? Why do they keep making the same bad decisions over and over and over again? And the reason is, many times, is because they're not equipped to do anything different. They don't have the tools in their toolbox to make the right decisions. They don't have the character necessary to do it right, and so they fail over and over and over again. And so rather than running them down, rather than mistreating them and writing them off, what they need is somebody to come alongside and show them how to do it better the next time. Show them how to make a difference in their lives and in the lives of others. So this week, we come to the Ghost of Christmas Present. the ghost of Christmas present. We have many things to learn from him, so we're going to get right into it after we pray together and ask God's blessing on the study here this morning. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for everyone that's gathered together here in this building today. We pray your blessing on each and every life. And Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to share the word of God this morning. Lord, I pray if there's someone here that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior, I pray that they would trust him today. Lord, that you would help us to show them how to become believers in Jesus Christ and to follow him with their lives. And Lord, I pray that you just speak to them and show them their need of heaven and salvation today. Lord, maybe there's somebody here today who's carrying a burden in their hearts that's unknown and unseen to us, but Lord, they need your help. They need your intervention. Lord, we pray for your grace and your mercy in their situation and their lives. And we'll thank you for what you do. Lord, help me as I preach. Give me wisdom. Give me stillness and quiet in my heart so that I can hear the Spirit of God speaking to me so that I can share it with others. And we'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, we're going to talk about the ghost of Christmas present here today, not the ghost of Christmas presence, right? There's a difference between that. Many of you are thinking right now, I need to be out shopping. I need to be out getting some Christmas presents taken care of. And by the way, there's only 9 shopping days left until Christmas, so guys, you better get on it. Now, there's only 7 days if you use Amazon Prime, okay? So, by the way, I know Amazon is open 24 hours a day, but for right now, for the next 30 or so minutes, it's closed, okay? Don't be shopping while I'm preaching, all right? She's going to see it, you're going to be in trouble anyways, so better not do it. But you have 9 shopping days, 9 opportunities left to get your Christmas presents taken care of. But that's not what we're talking about today. We're talking about the ghost of Christmas present as opposed to the ghost of Christmas past, right? The ghost of Christmas past rewinds Scrooge's life and takes him to the pivotal Christmases of his life, and the ghost of Christmas present is going to take Scrooge through that Christmas time, that Christmas season that he is experiencing at that moment. So let's start with the arrival of the Spirit. The arrival of the Spirit. Just as we looked at last time, we're going to talk about the arrival of the Spirit this week. Scrooge has fallen asleep after his traumatic experience with the ghost of Christmas past. He falls asleep, he wakes up again, and the bell tolls 1. He thinks that he has slept another day through, and so he hears the bell toll 1, and he's expecting that just as the ghost of Christmas past opens the curtains of his bed, he expects to see another hand, but there is no hand. 10 minutes pass, 15 minutes pass, and nothing happens. But Scrooge notices out of the corner of his eye a light underneath the door in the next room where his fireplace is. He gets out of bed and he slowly works his way towards the door. And you can imagine why he might be working his way slowly. You'd be kind of scared yourself. And he works his way towards the door. And as he reaches to grab the knob, someone calls out to him and says, "Ebenezer, come in." And he opens the door, and the sight that he sees is something he's never seen in that house before. He sees a shining room full of Christmas decorations, garlands strung on the walls and on the doors, holly berries everywhere, and a roaring fire in the fireplace, which had never been experienced in Scrooge's house. Remember, Scrooge liked the cold or the darkness because it's cheap. Right? And so he'd never stoked a real fire in that fireplace, and there's a roaring fire inside of that hearth, and he sees a large pile of Christmas food, turkeys and hams and dressing and all kinds of things like that, piled to the ceiling. And sitting on this pile of food is a giant of a man. A giant of a man. And so I read that and I said, well, how in the world do you sit on Christmas food? That seems a little unusual. How do you make a throne, a chair, out of Christmas food? And I think I've come up with the answer. There, he needed something firm, something somewhat like a brick or something like a log to hold him up. And so I think, the book doesn't say, but I think, that chair was somehow made out of, what's the word? What do you call it? You know what I'm talking about. Fruitcake. Fruitcake. I think he was sitting on fruitcake because that's the only thing hard enough at Christmas time to hold somebody up. And so he's sitting on this mound of dinner there, all of this food, and this ghost is clothed in a loose-fitting green robe. It's kind of like a tunic, or you fashion-forward ladies. I think y'all call them ponchos or whatever they are, sort of like that, right? And you military guys, you might know what a poncho is too, but he's sitting on this throne with this loose robe. He's carrying a torch in his hand, and on top of his head is a wreath, a Christmas wreath. I wasn't supposed to show you that side. I'm supposed to show you this side. There we go. A Christmas wreath is sitting on his head, and this wreath is going to be a symbol, and this torch is going to be a symbol of the work of the Ghost of Christmas Present. And so there's something unique about the Ghost of Christmas Present, something a little different than the Ghost of Christmas Past. Christmas Past was a shining, shimmering figure, translucent. Light proceeded from his head, and that light symbolized Scrooge's memories, his past, that you can never extinguish the light of your past, that you will always carry it with you. And so we better do good with the life that we have, because we'll carry the memories of our lives with us for the rest of our lives. There is no extinguishing the light of our memories. But this ghost has something unique about him. He is noticeably unkempt. His hair is wild and free. His feet are bare, which is an unusual thing in December in London, you can imagine. And his robe is loose and free-flowing. It doesn't fit him properly. And so the idea is that there's something wild and untamed about this man, about this giant. He is truly free. And the point is that Christmas should bring us to a place of freedom, not a place of bondage. That it should bring us to a place of liberation, not a place of being tied down. But I don't know about you, but that's the way my Christmases have sometimes felt. Haven't yours? Where you feel like you're in chains. I've got to do this, and then we've got to get the Christmas cards out, and then we've got this coming up, and we've got to make sure we get this taken care of, and we've got to have our shopping weekend, and we've got to do all of these things, and I've got to have so many presents for this child, and so many presents for this grandparent, and so much of this and that, and all these other things, that Christmas loses its freedom, and it becomes more like chains. And then comes middle January, when the credit card bill shows up for all of our Christmas fun. And then we're really in chains for the next 5 or 6 months as we're paying back the bank for all of the fun that we've had at Christmas time. But that's not the way Christmas is supposed to be, is it? Christmas is supposed to be a time of freedom, because Jesus Christ, when he came to this world, he came to bring freedom to the people of this world. We were made to be free, but because of sin, we have been put into chains. And we live with those chains. Many times we feel more comfortable in chains and in bondage than we do being free. That's an article of our brokenness. That's a piece of our brokenness showing through as human beings. But we were made to be free. And Jesus tells us in John chapter 8 that whomever the Son of God sets free, he is free indeed. No one can ever put him back into bondage. No one can ever again place him under slavery to something unless we ourselves place ourselves under voluntary slavery. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. You are free to be sure. And there ain't no way, no how, nobody can ever put you back into bondage as you used to be. Jesus came to bring us new life, full of real freedom, full of real liberty. Our world today is a world that is full of darkness. It is a world of chains. Slavery, for instance, has been a problem for a long time. It was a problem in Jesus' day. It was a problem in early American history, and it is an even bigger problem today than it ever has been. The United Nations reports that there are over 40 million slaves worldwide. 40 million people are in active slavery. in our world today. They are subject to some form of modern slavery, whether it's forced marriage, forced labor, trafficking, something like that. Think about this. 40 million people today. In the 400-year history of the American slave trade, about 12 million people were sold into slavery. And by the way, that's 12 million too many. But 12 million people were sold into slavery. Today, three times as many people are actively in slavery today as the whole 400 years of the Western slave trade. We have a problem in our world today. Our world is in chains. People are living in bondage. And by the way, do you know who's at the top of that list of slaves? You know who the most persecuted and oppressed religious group in the world today is? Think about it. You might say Muslims or Jews or Hindus or something like that. But truthfully, the most oppressed and persecuted people group or religious group in the world today is Christians. Christians far and away above anybody else. Our brothers and sisters in Christ are living in chains when they were meant to be free, when they were meant to be liberated. And not just our Christian brothers and sisters, but the people of this world, everyone was meant to breathe free air. But that is just not the case in our world today, and it's a bigger problem than it ever has been before. But for all of that persecution, for all of that oppression, there is a truth that the persecuted church understands that we seem to miss in our world today. That even when you are placed in chains, even when you're living in bondage, you can still be free. Because physically, you can be placed in chains. Physically, you can be placed in bondage, but no one can chain your soul. No one can chain your hearts. No one can chain your mind. And so even those who are in affliction today and who are suffering persecution, some who are even facing slavery today, they can know, and many of them do know, real freedom because of Jesus Christ. They have found the real freedom of the soul, the real freedom of the heart that Jesus brings. And even though they carry the affliction, they carry the burden of his cross, they know what it means to be free. Heather and I were listening to an audiobook on vacation as we were driving around about a Chinese man, a Chinese Christian who heads up a relief organization for persecuted Christians in China today. And by the way, we don't often think about that, but Chinese Christians are enduring major affliction. Many of them, their lives have been taken from them just because they teach and preach Jesus Christ. And China claims to have a religious liberty policy, but only the religion as they see fit. Only the way that they allow it to happen. They believe in state religion, not in free religion. And so we were listening to this audiobook about some of the accounts of Chinese Christians who are enduring things that you've never had to think about, who are dealing with problems that you've never even faced. I mean, good grief, the biggest problem that we face today is when somebody frowns at us when we tell them about Jesus. Somebody says, "I don't want to hear it," and we feel like we got to hang it up. I'll never do that again. I'll never endure that persecution again. Starbucks takes the Christmas scenes off of their cups, and we think the Church of Jesus Christ is being assailed. It's not good. It's not pleasant to endure, but friends, there's a whole lot worse going on in our world today that we need to be aware of. And these Chinese Christians, one of the stories that was mentioned in this book that just shook me, it convicted me. There was a man who was arrested for being a Christian, and he was taken to a prison camp. And there at the prison camp, they shaved all the prisoners' heads, and they were preparing to shave his head, and his daughter stood at the fence of the compound and saw her father standing in line out in the yard. And she screamed into him and said, "Father, you're innocent of any crime, but if you get out, people will think you are a criminal because of your shaved head." In China, people with shaved heads, many times people know they just came from a prison camp. This is a person who should not be trusted. This is a person who must be rejected. They must be thrown away in that society. The father told his daughter, knowing that that he was about to get his head shaved, he said, "God knows the number of the hairs on our heads, and he will not let one hair fall to the ground without his permission." As the guards got to the man and prepared to put those electric clippers up to his head, the clippers stopped working. They tried again and again, but the clippers malfunctioned again and again. They said, "Go get the other set and bring it out." They set that up and prepared, and they put those clippers to his head, and again, it would not cut. They would not function. They said something about his hair causing problems for the clippers, and they sent him away. They moved to the next prisoner, and all of a sudden the clippers worked again. And as the man, this Christian man, walked away, knowing what he's just told his daughter about, not one hair of your head will fall to the ground without the father's notice, he looked at his daughter and he smiled. Friends, we are not alone in this world. In the worst times of our life, in the worst times of your affliction, in the worst times of the persecuted church, God is there. We are not alone in this life. God is there to bring us freedom. And if Jesus makes us free through his gift of salvation, through the gift of his own giving of himself on the cross, if he makes us free, then you are free indeed, and there's nothing that can ever take that away. Christmas means freedom, because the founder of Christmas brought us real freedom and liberation from sin and from ourselves. The arrival of the Spirit. Let's talk quickly about the attendance of the Spirit. The attendance of the Spirit. What did the ghost of Christmas present want to show Ebenezer Scrooge? He takes him all over London and shows him how people are celebrating Christmas there in the city. But as he does, Scrooge sees him tipping the torch. Remember, he's got a wreath on his head and he's got a torch in his hand. He sees this ghost, this spirit, tipping his torch, and the embers and the ashes that are falling out of the torch are falling onto people's heads. They're falling into their Christmas dinners. But of course, none of this is physical, right? They're not actually physically there, so it doesn't burn anybody. Nobody gets hurt. It doesn't mess up anybody's food. This is not affecting anybody physically, but it is affecting them emotionally. And as he sprinkles this on them, he's giving them an extra dose of Christmas cheer, giving them an extra dose of happiness and joy for the season. And Scrooge asks him about the flavor of it. He sees him sprinkling it on the food, and he says, "Well, what kind of flavor would that add to somebody's Christmas dinner?" And as he asks that, the spirit responds to him, Scrooge asks him, "Does that always work? What's the flavor of it, and does it always work on people?" And the spirit responds that it works most for the poor ones, because they need it most. They need it most. They visit a couple of homes. They visit Bob Cratchit. Remember Bob Cratchit? We were introduced to him in chapter 1, and this is Scrooge's employee that works for him, that Scrooge mistreats and talks down to and has been very cold towards. And then they visit Ebenezer's nephew. One man is poor, but he's joyful, Bob Cratchit. Ebenezer's nephew is well off, but he's equally joyful. And they both have something else in common. The name of Ebenezer Scrooge hangs over them. The name of Ebenezer Scrooge shows up at both of their Christmas feast, but Ebenezer Scrooge is not there, not by their choice, but by his. He has rejected their invitation, he has rejected their kindness, and he has made both places a little more miserable because of his hard-hearted ways. But both of those homes have found a way to cope with him, either laughing about him or something else. Scrooge begins to realize something, that nobody's missing out without him, that by pushing away from other people, he's the one who is really lost. By rejecting others and building walls against people, he's the one who feels the hurt of that. I remember, just going to give you a personal story here that comes to mind. I remember when Heather and I were first talking about adoption several years ago. And they encouraged us at the adoption agency that we went through to be open to open adoptions. And an open adoption is essentially where you have a real relationship with the birth family. You're the adoptive parent. You're bringing the child into your home, but you have an open relationship with them. You send them pictures, even spend time with them, let the kids know who their birth family is, things like that. And I remember, I'm just going to be honest with you, when we first talked about that, I said, no way. No way. I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that. Closed. We're not going to have any sort of relationship with them. This is my kid. I was very cold, very stubborn about it. And then we got Victoria. And we didn't have any choice but to have an open relationship. Some of you know the story of that. We'll talk about it some other time. But just by virtue of the way that adoption worked, we didn't have any choice but to have an open adoption. And if I had to do had it to do all over again, I'd choose it open 100 times over. If I had closed myself off and said, no, no more people in my life, no one else is welcome in my life, I'd have missed out on some tremendous blessings. Be careful about the walls that you build up, because you're not hurting the people that you think you're hurting. They're not feeling the pain like you think they're feeling the pain. Many times, you're the one who hurts. You're the one who carries that hurt in your life. Now, before we move on, we do need to mention one more character. Tiny Tim. Tiny Tim. He is Scrooge's opposite. He's the opposite of this cold-hearted, angry man. This little, disabled, sickly son of Bob Cratchit is the light in this story. He's an innocent and faith-filled boy, but he's got a problem. He's got a problem. And the only person who can help is Ebenezer Scrooge. And we're going to find out a little bit more about that next week when we come back. Let's talk briefly here as we close up this morning about the accusation of the Spirit. The accusation of the Spirit. Earlier in the book, Scrooge is presented, I've told you this before, he's presented with three opportunities to do the right thing for someone else. He is confronted with somebody from his past, his nephew Fred, who represents his sister in his growing up years. He's presented with an opportunity to help someone that's going to deal with his future. We'll talk about that next week. But he's also confronted with someone in his very own present life, his present time and circumstances. He is at his office one day working, and some men come in the door, a couple of good-natured fellas, and they are charity men. They're coming to collect Christmas donations for the poor and the impoverished in London at that time. And they ask him, well, can we expect a donation from you this year? Because the poor have no place to go. Many of them are sleeping on the streets and they need a place to go. And Scrooge responds this way. He says, are there no prisons? Plenty of prisons, said the gentleman, laying down the pen again. And the union workhouses, demanded Scrooge, are they still in operation? They are still. I wish I could say they were not. The treadmill and the poor law are in full vigor then, said Scrooge. Both very busy, sir. And all of these places kind of fall on deaf ears today, but these are places where people are basically shackled. They're not much better than indentured servants in these places, really slaves. Children were put to work in these places, these union workhouses. In fact, Charles Dickens grew up working in a blacking factory, a union workhouse as a kid to provide for his family. And so these are horrible places to live. There's sickness that's rampant in these places. These are places of destitution and absolute desperation for people. And Scrooge says, oh, I was afraid from what you said at first that something had occurred to stop them in their useful course. I'm very glad to hear it. The men respond, many can't go there, and many would rather die. Scrooge flippantly says, if they would rather die, they'd better do it and decrease the surplus population. He's a hard-hearted, bitter man. The ghost of Christmas present confronts Scrooge about this. He replays the tape and turns Scrooge's own harsh and rash words against him. You ever said something that 5 seconds later you wish you'd never said? Or maybe a little while later, somebody brought it back up to you, and you said, I can't believe I said that. I can't believe I was that cold. I can't believe I was that rash. I can't believe I was that harsh. I didn't think before I spoke. I think we all have, and Ebenezer Scrooge is going to be confronted with that. Scrooge begins to show concern for Tiny Tim and for some other poor people, and the Spirit reminds Scrooge of what he said. Have they no refuge or resource, cries Ebenezer Scrooge. The Spirit says, are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? And the Spirit tells him to hear the insect on the leaf pronouncing on the too much life among his hungry brothers in the dust. And with that, the bell strikes 12. Scrooge is confronted with his own hatefulness, his own hard-heartedness. Why is it that we sometimes treat people the way we treat them? Many times it's because we've never even bothered to look at them. We've never even bothered to get where they are, to hear their stories. People say, well, let's feed the poor, and I think we should. But do we know why the poor are poor in the first place? Do we know why they don't have food? What are we doing about that problem? We see the people around us and we say they could just pick themselves up by their bootstraps and figure it out. If you were in their situation, how easy do you think it would be for you to pick yourself up by your bootstraps and change your situation? Now, I know some of you have fought through very difficult times and very difficult lives, and thank God for it, and we're proud of you for it, but it's nothing to lord over anyone else. I look at my situations and the difficulties that I've faced in life, and I think about the problems that I've had, and they pale in comparison to some of the people that I talk to and work with and deal with in our community week to week. And I go home and I say, thank God that I've never had to endure what they endure. Sometimes after talking with people about their marriages and relationships and things like that, I go home and I hug my wife and I say, thank God for you. Thank God for this marriage that we have. Thank God for the daughter that we have. And if we truly are thankful for what we have and what God has given to us, we will be generous with those who have it differently than us. We will be kinder to them. And many times all it takes is a conversation, just to sit down and hear why they're going through what they're going through. And instead of writing them off, instead of casting them aside and throwing them away, and said if they tried harder, if they were smarter, if they worked better, it'd be different. Maybe we ought to sit down with them and get to know the real story behind them, rather than being the insect on the leaf who has everything that heart could wish for, who has everything the way we need it, and cry down to those below us and say, too bad for you. Too bad for you. So I want to share with you real quickly here just a couple lessons from the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, that is. A few things that God tells us in his word that I think will help bring these ideas to life within us. Okay, Proverbs chapter 27, verse number 1 says, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. What should we understand about our Christmas present? Don't brag about what you're going to do tomorrow if you aren't ready to do it today. Don't brag about what you're going to do tomorrow if you're not prepared and willing to pull the trigger on it today. Many times we say, oh, I'll deal with that problem a little bit later. Well, then deal with it today. I'll help that person, or I'll reestablish that relationship at some other point. Well, what's wrong with today? God gave you today. You don't know if you're going to have tomorrow. Why not go ahead and deal with it as soon as possible? And you get what I mean by that. Maybe you don't need to make the phone call in the next 5 minutes, but are you making way for that to happen? Or are we just kicking the can down the road? Don't brag about tomorrow. Get something done today. Accomplish something today. Oh, when I get better financially set up and things work out, then I'll become a generous person. Then I'll give to the Lord. I'll give to other people. I'll give to the needs of the people around me. You will never be wealthy enough to do that. There will always be something competing for the funds in our bank account. we better get started today. Because first of all, I don't know if I'm going to have tomorrow. I don't know what tomorrow is going to look like. And someone will be there to chew it up. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, don't worry about the problems of tomorrow. Worry about the problems of today. Tomorrow's problems, they're going to be there when you arrive, okay? Don't worry about those. You take care of today. Second thing we can learn from this, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 13 says, but exhort one another daily while it is called today. So enjoy today while it is still today. Enjoy today while it is still today. Many times we look back on our lives, we look back on our experiences, and we say, I only wish that I had enjoyed that more, that I had put more into that, that I had tried harder at that, or that I had enjoyed that person more, I'd spent more time with them and gotten to know them, or whatever the situation might be. Get the most out of your today while it is today. God has put something into your life in this 24-hour period that he wants you to have, that he wants you to experience, that he wants you to do something with. Squeeze every drop you can out of it. Get everything you can out of it and put everything you can into it, because we only have today for today. Tomorrow it's gone. And I don't want to look back on my life and look back at all of those todays that I wasted and say, I wish I'd done more. I wish I'd built better relationships. I wish I'd worked harder at this. I wish I'd grown in the Lord more in these areas. Enjoy today while it is still today, and enjoy it. Enjoy the ride. Life doesn't have to be affliction. Life doesn't have to be a constant burden. Enjoy the blessings that come with it as well. And then thirdly, James chapter 1, verse 2 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. He's saying here that there is often an unseen work that God is doing behind the scenes, that God is up to something behind the scenes. And all we see are the situations. We see the problems. We see the difficulties. But we need to understand the real source of the problem. We need to uncover the real source of our difficulties. At the end of the chapter, in a Christmas carol, two new spirits emerge. They come out from under the robe of the ghost of Christmas present. They are two wretched children, and they're filthy and wild. Their names are Ignorance and Want. Ignorance and Want. And he means by that lack of education and living in poverty. These two wretched spirits that come out, and the ghost of Christmas present warns Scrooge about these two things, ignorance and want, and their presence in the world today. And the idea is that while Scrooge saw the beauty and the wealth and the magnificence of the giant of Christmas, behind the scenes, there was an unseen problem of ignorance and want. They were always there. They accompanied everything that happened that Christmas day that Scrooge experienced, and he never saw it. He never understood that it was there. Can I tell you this? Many times we're too busy scraping the surface of life, and we miss what's really going on. Many times we scrape the surface of our community, and we don't even know what's going on under the surface. Let's go on visitation sometime, and I'll show you the difficulties that people are facing, the problems that people are enduring in our own town, in our own community, that we would be shocked to know is going on right here. At the people we see at Casey's, people we see at Hy-Vee, you'd be shocked to know that that's always there under the surface. That's always there going on beyond your sight. Underneath the surface, these things are always simmering. And let me just encourage you with this. A lot of times we spend our lives being busy about things that are good, but how many of those things are really the best things for us to be doing? Are they really getting at the source of the problem? Are they really getting at the nature of the issue that we need to deal with? The Christian life is not about choosing between what is good and is bad. It is about choosing between what is good and what is needed. what is needed in our lives and in the lives of other people. We can burn up a lot of our lives focusing on things that don't make any difference whatsoever. You ever heard of FOMO? You know what FOMO is? It's the fear of missing out. The fear of missing out. And we live in a society that is eat up with it. It is an epidemic. And we'll spend all of our time trying to make sure we're up on everything and we've got this and we've got that and we're taking care of this and we're taking that. And what's the difference? What does it matter? Is it really important? Don't get so wrapped up in these things that you don't add any real value to your life or to your family. Let's not get so wrapped up in the shine and bells and whistles of Christmas that we miss what's really going on out there, that we miss the needs that people have and the needs that we have in our lives. Scrooge was good at making excuses, and so are we. He could find all kinds of reasons to step aside and stay out of the way and let them deal with it and let it be their problem. Somebody else will care for them. You know why we say that? Because we don't want the need to become personal. I'd rather you deal with the problem than me deal with the problem. Because if I have to deal with the problem, it becomes personal. And when it gets personal, it gets real. They have all they need. They have what they need. They're okay. Would it be all you need if it were all you had? Would you be satisfied? Would you be content in that situation, in that brokenness, in that difficulty that they're enduring? Would to God we had a little more sympathy for those who have it differently than we do. You know, Charles Dickens wrote A Christmas Carol in just 6 weeks. 6 weeks' time. Incredibly fast for a book. And he released the book on December 19th, 1843. It sold out in 3 days. People just craved this story. But the amazing part, though, is that when the book was released, charitable giving soared overnight. Because people were confronted with the fact that there is a problem out there. It's right under the surface. You don't have to look far to see it. Just pull back the robe a little bit and you'll see it. Let's do something about it. Let's make a difference. Let's do what little bit I have with my little abilities, what little bit I have with my little opportunities, but I'm not going to leave this world without making the future better. Because I used the present that God gave to me and put it into practice. And by the way, we have all that we need right here in this book to do that. The Christmas Carol is a fun book. I'm enjoying going through it with you. I hope you are too. But what we really need is the truth of this book. This book has all the counsel, has all the wisdom, has all the information that we need to make the difference that God wants to make in Unionville, Northeast Missouri, Southeast Iowa, and in your house, in your family. So this Christmas, let's stay in the present and let's do something about the future. Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. I thank you for the attentiveness of your people here this morning. Lord, I pray that you would help us as we think on these things. Lord, Christmas is coming. And it's going to be a fun day. We're going to enjoy each other's company at church here on the Christmas Eve service. We've got good things planned. But Lord, help us never to lose sight of the fact that we've been called to touch hearts and touch lives. And Lord, that's not always monetary. That's not always involving finances. Many times, that's not even necessary. What people need is the love of Jesus Christ. They need the love of Calvary in their hearts and their lives. Lord, I pray that we would be faithful and diligent to look for opportunities to give that to those who need it most. Lord, we have been so freely given to. Lord, I think about just as a young boy, trusting Jesus Christ as my Savior, and the gospel came freely to me. Lord, may we freely give to others who need it. Lord, I pray that you'd bless us in this time of invitation and speak to our hearts, we pray. For it's in the name of the Lord Jesus we ask these things. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed here this morning, maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Brian, I know I'm saved, I know I'm on my way to heaven, and I can tell you why from the Bible. If that's you this morning, you know that you're on your way to heaven, would you just slip your hand up there as a testimony of praise to the Lord this morning? Amen. Thank you. Thank you. You can put your hands down there. If you were unable to raise your hand, can I tell you this? God wants you to know. And we'd love to take the Bible today and show you how you can know that your sins can be forgiven, and that your name can be written down in heaven from now until forever. We'd love to help you with that today. We're going to have a time of invitation and prayer here in just a minute. And as we do, why don't you just come forward and get my attention and say, Pastor Brian, I want to go to heaven. We'd love to help you with that today. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Brian, I know I'm saved. I know I'm on my way to heaven, but God's speaking to me. Maybe it has something to do with what we talked about today. Maybe it has something to do with the Nazarene Fund and your giving in that. Maybe it has something to do with your own personal life and your family trying to make the most of what you've got. But God's speaking to you about something we mentioned today, or maybe something completely different. But you say, God's at work in my heart today, and I want to respond. If that's you today, would you just slip your hand up there as a testimony this morning? I just want to pray for you. Amen. Amen. Hands around the room. Thank you so much. Let's stand together. The music team's going to come back, and they're going to lead us in a hymn of invitation, Just As I Am. And I know sometimes you probably listen to me and you say, boy, he's hard on us. You know, it's Christmas time. Lighten up a little bit. But the reason I say things as I say them is because I know what you're capable of. I know what you're capable of. My wife and I felt so much love and appreciation in the 3 years that we've been here. And I tell you, our community's feeling it too. A few weeks ago, we had our weekend of service opportunity, and many of you were out and helping with that as you were available, and I thank you for it. And we got several thank you cards in the mail, and I've gotten several messages from people saying, thank you for doing that. That was a blessing. One lady said, I'm going to be there Christmas Eve. I want to be there and be a part of that. And God's on the move if we'll get moving. God will do some things if we'll do some things. So I just thank you so much for your faithfulness there. We'll do that again. You say, well, I didn't get to be a part of that. Well, we'll give you an opportunity in the future. I promise you'll love it. We had a great time that weekend. A little strange, wasn't it, to not come to church on Sunday morning? But I appreciate those of you that made the effort and that were able to come. Those of you that weren't able to come, we'll have more opportunities in the future to do these sorts of things and get you involved. But thank God for it, and praise the Lord for his work on that weekend. And then just a couple of announcements I want to share with you. If you have your bulletin, you can look that over with me. But this evening out at Omaha Baptist Church, they're doing a presentation, a Christmas program tonight. I'm not sure of the time of that, honestly. I think it might be 6 o'clock. Is it 6? Okay. 6 o'clock tonight, Omaha's presentation. You'll enjoy it. There's food, desserts, things like that. It's just a good time. So if you can be there, you'll get a blessing out of it. Tonight, 6 o'clock, Omaha Baptist Church. And then next weekend, I already said it, but we will have the kids singing Christmas carols here on Sunday morning next Sunday. So it'll be a good opportunity to invite some friends and family out. They'll have a blast with that, watching those kids. And then Christmas Eve service is coming up. We're going to have normal services on next Sunday. And then for about 45 minutes, starting at 5 o'clock on Monday, the 24th, we will be here for our Christmas Eve candlelight service. So I hope you'll be in attendance for that and invite some others who don't normally go to church, or maybe they've got something else, work obligation, something like that. This might be an opportunity for them to come. We'd love to see them there, but it'll be about 45 minutes. And then Wednesday night, we'll continue with our normal scheduled service on Wednesday night on the 26th. Also, the Nazarene Fund, mentioned that. We've got one more week to give towards that, so hope you'll be giving towards that next week if you haven't already. And pay it forward to some fellow believers. And then birthdays. You got any birthdays to celebrate this week? I know of at least, well, I guess it's not this week. Okay. Anyways, moving right along. All right, Donna, you have a birthday? All right, happy birthday. Judy, when was yours? Oh, it's the 21st. Okay, well, happy birthday. Lexi's the 22nd. All right, happy birthday. Anyone else? I will kick off anniversaries. My wife and I are celebrating our 13th anniversary today, and I appreciate her and all that she does. I know you do for all that she does around here, but the blessing that she is to me. But happy anniversary, babe, if I haven't said it already. And anyone else? Any anniversaries to celebrate? All right, then. Well, stop by the Resource Center and get a gift on behalf of the church. Heather, I think there's some manhood books back there you might want to get for me on being a good husband and all that good stuff. So if you want to go back there and get it, we'll put it on the bookshelf. All right? But anyways, glad to see you here today. Let's stand together and we'll be dismissed in a word of prayer. Stick around, join us for lunch, and we will dine together in just a minute. And then we do need to go over the choir song we'll be singing next week, Lord willing. So we need to go over that choir song again. So let's meet back in here about 12:40, and we'll get going on that. All right, let's pray together and ask God's blessing as we dismiss here today. Dr. Williams, would you please dismiss us, sir?